सहनावतु सहनो भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं।
दिस टेक्स्ट आत्मबोध इज कंपोज्ड बाय भगवान श्री आदिशंकराचार्य जी। इट कंटेन्स ऑल द फंडामेंटल प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ वेदांत। द यूनिक फीचर अबाउट दिस टेक्स्ट इज for every important principle there is an example, an apt example given to make the concepts clear. Moreover, in this text the Sanskrit is very simple, so those who would like to study Sanskrit, this text can be really helpful. Very many people get the entire text by heart also. Right. So in the first verse, Bhagwan very clearly indicates the qualification necessary to get benefited by this Vedantic knowledge. What should be the qualification? A person who has quietened the mind, made the mind pure, free from all kinds of worldly agitations, and a person who sincerely, from the depth of the heart, he must seek liberation. For such a person, this text is composed. Now, here in the first verse, we find what is called as Anubandha Chatushtayam. Anubandha Chatushtayam. What is Anubandha Chatushtayam? These four. Number one, who is the adhikari of this text? Who is the qualified person? So in the first verse it is said mumukshunam. So this text is meant for whom? Mumukshu. Point number two, what is the vishaya of this text? What is the subject matter? What is the subject matter? Atmabodha. The subject matter is the knowledge of the self. Point number three, what will I get after gaining this knowledge? What is the prayojana? So prayojana, what is the prayojana? So mumukshuna, so moksha is the prayojana. The purpose of study is moksha, liberation. The fourth one is sambandha. What is the relationship between the vishaya and the prayojana? What is the relationship between studying the text and gaining the knowledge? What is the relationship? So we say the relationship is bodhya bodhaka sambandha. You gain the knowledge and that itself is liberation. You don't have to do anything else. If you have a prepared mind, the gaining the knowledge itself will lead you to liberation. Unlike the text, like for example, say, a book on asana and pranayama. You have to know it, then you have to do it, then only you will be benefited. Isn't it? That is called as chodya chodana sambandha. The book gives you the knowledge of what to do, then you practice it, do it, and then you gain the benefit. What about here? If the mind is prepared, the very listening can give you the knowledge. Knowing itself is the culmination. There is no doing. Knowing itself will give you liberation. Right. Now how this text starts? The text starts by giving the importance of knowledge. What does Bhagavan say? Bhagavan says, compared to all the other sadhanas, this sadhana, gaining self-knowledge, is the direct means for liberation. Jnanam vina mokshah na siddhyati. Moksha is impossible without knowledge. So yesterday we were discussing why this statement is made. So what is the meaning of moksha? Moksha means liberation. Moksha means freedom. So if I want freedom, it simply implies that I am bound. Now what is the nature of bondage here? Here the nature of bondage is illusory. Actually speaking, there is no bondage. The bondage is only a notion in the mind. If bondage is only a notion in the mind, how to remove that notion? You have to remove that notion by right understanding. If the bondage is physical, suppose somebody has tied you onto a what you call pole. If the bondage is created by action, then how to get liberated by that bondage? Action alone has to liberate. If action has created bondage, action alone can give you liberation. But if a wrong notion has created the bondage, then what has to be done? Action is of no use. That wrong notion has to be removed. How to remove that wrong notion? By right knowledge. This is the only way. Because bondage is illusory, and that bondage is merely because of the ignorance of oneself. So the only way to remove that bondage is by removing the ignorance. And ignorance can be removed only by knowledge. So a lot of examples are given in Vedanta. For example, like the camel. So there was a person who was carrying his camel. So it was night and he wanted to rest somewhere. So there he saw one tent. He went inside. There was one person. He took permission. So then he found that he did not have a rope to tie the camel. So he told the person, now what to do? If I don't tie the camel will go somewhere. So then that person said, don't do anything. Just act as though you are tying the camel. Camel should see that you are tying. Just do that. So this person did exactly that. Next day morning he sees that the camel is standing there. It has not gone anywhere. So he thanks his friend, and then as he leaving, camel is not moving. So again he comes to this person and says, now the camel is not moving. Then he asks, did you untie the camel? He said, but I have never tied the camel. That is for you. But as far as the camel is concerned, it has this notion that I am tied. So therefore, have you untied it? Go and untie and that camel will come with you. So this person again unties it. Actually, there is no tying, there is no untying. So it is a notion in the mind of the camel that I am being tied. I have been tied, so I am bound. So what kind of bondage it is? It's a notional bondage. So a notional bondage can be removed only by right understanding. So therefore, Bhagavan says, avirodhitaya karma na avidyam vinivartayet. So how can action remove ignorance? Ignorance can go only by knowledge. Just like darkness can go only by light. Light is the antidote to darkness. In the same way, knowledge alone is the antidote to ignorance. What is the effect of this ignorance? Parichinna iva ajnanat. A person feels parichinna, limited. What is the proof that I am ignorant? The proof is, I think that I am limited by this body. If we experience this, that itself is a sign of ignorance. We think we are limited to this body. So what happens when the knowledge arises? Tannashe sati kevalaha. We come to know that we are none other than consciousness, which is all-pervading, which is non-dual, which is one without a second. Now a question comes. See, if this is the final culmination, that I come to know myself as infinite consciousness without any duality, then how will I know this state of infinity? Because in every knowing, these three things are involved. What are they? Knower, known, and the process of knowing. This is called Triputi. The knower knows the object. So there is a knower, there is an object to be known, and there is a process of knowing. So whenever a knowing happens, these three factors are involved. Now what is said? Once the ignorant goes away, tannashe sati kevalaha. Kevalaha means only one. So if there is only one, how can knowing happen? Because in every knowing, these three factors are involved. Knower, known, and the process of knowing. Now you say there is only one. How can knowing happen? So to make it understand, make it clear, Bhagavan gives an example. Swayam prakashate hi atma megha apaye amshuman iva. Bhagavan says, this consciousness is such that it knows itself by itself. As far as this rule is concerned, that there has to be a knower separate from the known, all those rules are not applicable here, because the nature of consciousness, what is the nature of consciousness? Knowing is the nature of consciousness. So consciousness knows itself by itself. That property of knowing is the property of consciousness. It is its natural property. Swayam prakashate hi atma. Atma swayam prakashate. It shines by itself. Now ask this question to ourselves. To know myself, what do I need? To know my own existence. I know I exist. I am conscious of my existence. To know myself, what support do I need? Do I need my eyes? Do I need my ears? I don't need any of the sense organs. In fact, I don't need even my mind also. Even without any of my senses and the mind, I am aware of my existence. How am I aware? That awareness is the nature of Atma, is the nature of the self. Swayam prakashate, by itself. To know myself, I don't need the support or assistance of anything. Without any instruments, I know myself. To make it clear, one example is given. Just like when the clouds go away, the sun shines by itself. So this cloud is compared with ignorance. So when ignorance is not there, the sun is not seen. Sun is compared with the self. So now you are seeing only the cloud, sun is not seen. But when ignorance goes away, do you need another light to see the sun? Suppose there is a watch, your watch is missing. It is on the table, but a lot of papers are lying there. So what do? You have to remove the paper and then you have to bring in light also to see the watch, isn't it? Two things are to be done. Remove the obstacle, bring in light. That is because watch is not self-luminous. What about the sun? It is self-luminous, therefore a separate light is not needed. Only removal of the obstacle alone is what has to be done. In the same way, this consciousness is shining by itself. We don't know the glory of this consciousness. We think this consciousness is inside the body, or we think that the body itself is me. This consciousness is defined as the body. So therefore we don't know. But when the right knowledge comes, what happens? The ignorance goes away and this consciousness shines by itself. So these are all very important verses at the seat of meditation. At the seat of meditation, what do you experience? You experience consciousness. So at that time, all this knowledge has to be brought into the mind. This consciousness is not limited in the body. It is all-pervading. And this consciousness is me. This is the jnana abhyasa to be done, which is mentioned in the next verse. Let us chant the next verse. Verse number 5.
Ajnana kalusham jivam jnanabhyasat vinirmalam krutva jnanam swayam nashyet jalam katakarenuvat.
Ajnana kalusham jivam. This jiva, this individual who is defiled by ignorance. So what he has to do? Jnana abhyasat, by the practice of jnana. Jnana abhyasa. Now what is this jnana abhyasa? So at present, I have this firm wrong notion in me that I am this body. This sense of individuality is strong in me. This is called as ajnana. I don't know myself. I think myself to be the body. This notion in the mind is called ignorance. So what should you do to remove this ignorance? Three stages. One is Shravana, second is Manana, and the third one is Nididhyasana. So Shravana, the first thing is you are exposed to this knowledge. And what is this knowledge? You are not the body, you are pure consciousness. Somebody has to tell us. Otherwise, we will never know. So, Shravana means listening to the teachings of the scriptures, listening to Guru. Guru Upadesha. So, you are not this body, you are the consciousness which is witnessing this body. So, what is the second statement? What is the statement brought by the scriptures? I am not body, I am consciousness. So, what is Jnana Abhyasa? So first of all, you have to clear all the doubts. Using the logic given by the scriptures, you clear all the doubts. And that is the process of mananam. Doubts are cleared. Then you do nididhyasanam. What do you do in nididhyasanam? The wrong thinking is replaced by the right understanding. Wrong notion has to be replaced by right understanding. So this wrong notion has got deep into our personality to such an extent that it has become our nature to think ourselves to be the body. It has become a habit. It is very deep rooted. A particular thought is there in our mind that I am this and this much alone. I am this body. This thought has gained deep root in our mind. So how to remove this wrong thought? Wrong thought has to be replaced by the right understanding, which is also a kind of thought only. And what is the thought? I am not this body, I am consciousness. This is called jnana abhyasa. Every time the wrong thought comes, replace it by the right understanding. Make it a habit. Make it a habit to know yourself, to identify yourself with consciousness. And how is habit made? By repeated practice. That repeated practice is what is called as jnana abhyasam. Keep on doing it, and slowly, 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 what will happen? You will take yourself to be consciousness functioning through the body. Body is not given importance. What is given importance? Consciousness is given importance. Now, here a question is raised. The question is, see, you are replacing the wrong thought by right understanding. But that right understanding is also a kind of thought. So in short, you are replacing wrong thought with a right thought. But still, that knowledge is also a thought. How can a mere thought be called knowledge? If it is a mere thought, then during sleep you will lose everything. Only in the waking state you will be benefited. In the dream and deep sleep state, this thought will go away. Because any thought cultivated will go in the dream and deep sleep state. So how can you call it absolute knowledge? So here Bhagavan is clarifying that doubt. What does Bhagavan say? No doubt you are right. But here, this right understanding, which is a kind of thought, it replaces the wrong thought, but after replacing, even this right understanding also goes away. It no more remains as a thought. Ajnana kalusham jivam jnana abhyasat vinirmalam krutva jnanam swayam nasyet. This knowledge, after having destroyed the wrong notion in the mind, gets destroyed itself. So the right thinking destroys the wrong thinking, and the right thinking also gets destroyed by itself. Now what does it mean? See, what is wrong thinking? The notion that I am this body. Right? It's a thought in the mind. What is right thinking? I am consciousness. Now, the wrong thinking is replaced by the right thinking. Now what is the thinking? I am consciousness is the thinking. Now the question is, to know yourself as consciousness, do you need thoughts? Do you need thoughts to know yourself as consciousness? No! I am conscious, I am aware. Consciousness has nothing to do with thoughts. Consciousness is an independent entity which need not take the support of thoughts to make itself present. You cannot think of consciousness. You can only be conscious. Are you able to get it? It's a subtle thought. I am consciousness, you use that thought, and slowly you drop that thought and only remain as consciousness. You take the support of the thought. Which thought? It's called as Brahmakara Vritti. I am Brahman. Aham Brahmasmi. You take that support. And slowly what happens? You start feeling it to such an extent that you need not think about it. Are you getting it? Now you are not thinking, you are experiencing. When you are experiencing, you need not think. Thought is no more necessary. The experience of consciousness need not have the support of the thoughts. So in the process what happens? The right thought destroys the wrong thought, and the right thought also goes away. Now what alone remains? Consciousness alone remains. Mind also goes away. What remains is only consciousness. To make it clear, one example is given. What is example? Jalam kataka renuvat. Like water into which kataka renu has been put. Renu means dust. Kataka is a nut of a particular tree. It's a nut. So in olden days, during the rainy season, the water would become muddy. So how to remove that mud from the water? So that mud is in a suspended state, the whole water is muddy. So what they used to do is, they used to take this kataka nut and then powder it. This powder they would put upon the water. So what happens to this powder? This powder, they attach themselves to the suspended mud particles. And when it attaches, what happens to the weight? It becomes heavier. And because it becomes heavy, it goes down and settles down as sediments. So what has happened to water now? It has become pure. All the suspended particles, they get attached to this dust of kataka nut and then they become sediments. Just like alum. Alum also does the same thing. Nowadays you have that alum. So if you want to make the water clean, pure, you take that solid block and just move it once or twice and then leave that water. Overnight you will find all the mud particles have settled. So now, how this example is related to this? See, the water was already muddy. So into the mud you are putting another set of impurity. So we may think that now you are increasing the impurity of the water. But now what is happening? The dust is helping to remove the impurity which is already present. Already a wrong notion is there in the form of thought. You bring another thought, destroy that thought, and both the thoughts are gone. What remains is only consciousness. Wrong thought is destroyed by the right thought, and the right thought automatically gets destroyed once you start experiencing your true identity. To give another example, so here is this person who is being chased by a tiger in the dream. So in the dream, this is what he is seeing. He is being chased by the tiger. And then what happens? Suddenly he wakes up. What is the cause of his waking up? The dream tiger. So what has the dream tiger done? Dream tiger is also a part of the dream, but that tiger helps him wake up from the dream. Isn't it? Something of the dream helping this person wake up from the dream. Are you able to understand? Something of the dream helping the person wake up from the dream. After waking up, is the tiger there? No, tiger is also gone. Tiger helps this person wake up, but after waking up, there is no tiger also. So what has the tiger done? By helping this person wake up from the dream, and after making this person wake up from the dream, the tiger also is destroyed. Another example is given in Bhagavatam. Suppose lot of thorns are there on your feet. What do you do? Now you have to remove those thorns. How do you remove? Take one more thorn. Problem is created by the thorns, but what do? You take another thorn and then remove all the thorns and finally throw away that also. This is what this Brahmakara Vritti does. This is what the Jnana Abhyasa does. Jnana Abhyasa is also taking the support of a thought, but it is that thought which will destroy all the thought, and finally what remains is only consciousness. When children are making noise in the class and the teacher comes, what does the teacher do? Problem is noise. So what will the teacher do? Teacher will create another noise which will put an end to all noise. Isn't it? With the help of another noise, he or she puts an end to all noise. Now what is remaining? She shouts, silence! It's a noise. But what is end result? End result is total silence. The previously present noise also gone. This person's voice also gone. So now ultimate end result is only silence. These are all the various examples given in our scriptures. Another beautiful example is given in Bhagavatam again. A firewood is potentially fire. So what do? You light up a fire and the firewood is burnt. And once the firewood is burnt, what happens to the fire? The fire also goes away. It lights up the fire, destroys the firewood, and it by itself gets destroyed. Now ultimately what remains? Nothing remains. This is exactly what Jnana Abhyasa does. So in the beginning, there is this ignorance that I am this body. So at the seat of meditation, what do? You bring in this thought. All the Vedantic thoughts are brought in so that non-Vedantic thoughts are destroyed, replaced. It is substituted by the Vedantic thought. Every thought has to happen in the mind. Now this Vedantic thought, by remaining there, destroys the non-Vedantic thought, and finally what remains? Vedantic thought also goes away. What remains is only consciousness. When you say, I am consciousness, first you take the help of a thought, and finally when you start experiencing consciousness, that thought also drops away. Take the support, drop it. Just like, if suppose the moon is there and you want to show the moon, what do you do? Look at the moon. You use your hand. So what will the other person do? In the same direction he keeps on looking. And once he has found the moon, this hand is no more required, isn't it? Drop the hand. Then what remains? Only the experience of moon remains. So here Bhagavan says, in the beginning you must take the thought of Vedantic understanding. Finally, automatically it will drop away. What will remain is only the experience of pure consciousness, for which no thought is needed. And once you start experiencing consciousness, this experience will remain whether you are in dream or deep sleep. It no more depends on the mind. It depends on your state of being, and your state of being is always there, whether you are in waking or dream or deep sleep. That becomes permanent knowledge. That becomes absolute knowledge. Now another question. Bhagavan, I understand that I am not the body, I am consciousness. I understand. But what about the world? I have understood myself, but what about this world which I am seeing so solid in front of me? So that question is answered in the next verse. Verse number 6.
Samsara swapna tulyohi ragadveshadi sankulah swakale satyavadbhati prabodhe satya sadbhavet.
Yes. What about this world? Does this world have separate existence from me? Bhagavan says, samsarah swapna tulyah. This world is like a dream. So here another example. What is example? The example of a dream is given. The samsara, which is ragadveshadi sankulah, filled with ragadvesha, likes and dislikes. What is this samsara? It is swapna tulyah. In what way this samsara is swapna tulyah? Like a dream. Swakale satyavad bhati. When you are in the dream, you very much feel that the dream world is absolutely real. You can't even doubt it. But prabodhe, when you wake up, what is your experience? Prabodhe sati asat bhavet. It becomes asat, unreal. Meaning, this world has no separate existence other than you. Now let us analyze this dream. So when we enter into the dream, in the dream world, what all do we see? Exactly whatever we find in this world, in this waking world, the same thing you will find in the dream world also. What all things? There is time, there is dream time, there is dream space, there is a dream body with which you interact with dream people, isn't it? You are not using the waking body, you are using the dream body. A separate body has been created in the dream by the mind for you. So in the dream world, you interact with the dream body and you have your own dream senses also. Eyes are there, ears are there, all the sense organs are also there in the dream. Dream experiences are there. And the laws are also almost the same. Law of gravity, everything is there in the dream also. So literally you will find your mind has created a world of its own. But taking the support of whom? The entire dream world exists. But from where did the dream world borrow its existence? The dream world borrows its existence from the waker. Isn't it? Who exists? Only the waker exists. It is this existence which is misunderstood as the existence of the dream world. By itself, the dream world has no existence. But it appears to exist, borrowing the existence from the waker. In the same way, the whole world which we see, it has no existence by itself. It only borrows existence from me. This is the way you have to say. I, the infinite consciousness, give existence to the entire world. World by itself has no existence. So what Bhagwan is saying is, once you have known yourself, you have known everything. There is nothing else to be known. The whole creation revolves around you. You are the most important. Now in our misunderstanding, what is our understanding? What is our misunderstanding? Our misunderstanding is, I am in the world. What is the right understanding? The world is in me. My wrong understanding is, I depend on the world for my existence. What is the right understanding? The world depends on me for its existence. Now see, the whole thing is changed. The world has no existence by itself. It depends on me for its existence. Compare with the dream world. The entire dream world depends on the waker. Isn't it? The same thing is true here also. But this you will never understand as long as you are not awake. Just like the dream. In the dream, suppose some dream guru comes and tells you, the whole world has no existence, you alone exist. Will you believe? Will you accept his words? Never. So that's why it is said, Svakale Satyavad Bhati. When you are dreaming, everything appears to be so solid, so real, you can't even doubt it. But when you wake up, Prabodhe Asad Bhavet. Same way in this waking also, the whole world has no existence. Who exists? You alone exist as consciousness. The rest, everything is a projection. The mind has projected this world, taking existence from you. The same idea is further clarified in the next verse. Verse number 7.
Tavat satyam jagat bhati shukti karajatam yatha yavanna jnayate brahma sarvadhishthanam advayam.
Yes. Tavat, till then, jagat satyam bhati. Till then you will think that the world is real. Jagat satyam. As long as yavanna jnayate brahma, as long as you don't know who is Brahman, this pure consciousness which is sarva adhishthanam, which is the very substratum, very support of the whole universe. As long as we don't know this Brahman, which is the substratum, which is the support of the whole universe, which is advayam, non-dual, which is only one. Till we don't know the truth, till then, jagat satyam bhati. Till then, we will consider jagat as true, as real, as self-existing. Just like an example is given. What is example? Shuktika rajatam yatha. Like shuktika rajatam. Shuktika means shell, which you find on the seashore. The shell is called shuktika. Rajatam means silver. So shuktika rajatam means shell silver. Now what is shell silver? So when you walk on the beach, very many times this happens, you find something very shining. far away you find that there is something shining. The sun is also shining, and that sun is reflected in that piece. And now you, by mistake, think that it is silver. Now the greed comes. You are attracted. You look around. Nobody is seeing. Now slowly you go there with all desire. First you stand upon it. And when you make sure that nobody is seeing, then slowly you pick it up. And what do you get? You find that it is no silver. It is a mere shell. A useless shell. Isn't it? So this is called a raga. So the first thing is you consider world as satyam, real. And then after superimposing reality onto it, what do? You have raga and dvesha. So in this example it is raga. In the other famous example of Vedanta, what is the other famous example? Rajju sarpa. The rope is misunderstood as snake. There it is dvesha. In this it is raga. You run towards something, you run away from something else. When you are not able to see the reality, it creates a lot of raga dveshas in you. All because you don't know the reality. So what does Bhagavan say here? As long as the truth is not known, the untruth, the illusion will create problems for you. This is what the ignorance does. Ignorance does two things. Number one, it covers the reality from your experience. And number two, it projects unreal as real. This is what ignorance does. Number one, avarana. Avarana means covering the truth. Number two, vikshepa, projecting the untruth as truth. This is what ignorance does. So here in this case, you don't see the shell, then what do you see? You see the silver, which is only a projection of the untruth. The substratum is the same. Because there is a shell, you are able to see the silver. Substratum is the same, but you don't see the thing as it is. You see something else in its place. This is what ignorance does. And this is what Bhagavan is saying. In the dream also the same thing happens. What is there, you don't see. What is not there, you see. What is actually there, the waker alone is there. He is comfortably sleeping on his bed. That you don't see. What do you see? You see the projected world, projected, unreal, illusory world you see. This is what ignorance does. So what Bhagavan is trying to say is, the moment you know yourself as you are, all the problems are solved. Problems within and problems without, outside. The same idea is again mentioned in the next verse. Verse number 8.
Upadane khiladhare jagante parameshware sargasthitilayan yanti budbudani vavarini.
Yes. Jaganti. Jaganti means plural of jagat. Jagat means world. So plural of world is jaganti, worlds. So millions and billions of worlds, galaxies, cosmoses, universes, you may use any term. What is happening? Sarga, sthiti, layan, yanti. Constantly that is what is happening. Sarga, creation, sthiti, sustenance, laya, dissolution. Millions and billions of galaxies are created and destroyed. But what is the support? Upadane akhiladhare parameshware yanti. What is the support? Parameshwara, the Supreme Lord. Who is the upadana? Who is the material cause? And akhila adhara, who is the very substratum. Upon him, millions and billions of worlds come, they appear, they remain for some time and go back. How? Like budbudaniva varini. Like the bubbles appearing in water. Bubbles appearing in water. Now what is the essence of any bubble? The essence of any bubble is water. The name may be different, the form may be different, the size may be different, but actually speaking, it is nothing but water. It comes, appears for some time, goes. And this way millions of bubbles come and go. Where? Everything happens in water. Water is the substratum, isn't it? In the same way, all these galaxies, millions and billions of them, we don't know how many, they come, they remain and go back. Now, interestingly, galaxies, they exist for millions and millions of years. Those galaxies are compared with a water bubble. Just imagine. Meaning, time-wise limitation, space-wise limitation. What is a bubble? Few seconds, it roams around and then gone. Isn't it? Galaxies are compared with these bubbles. Why? The galaxies, they exist for millions of years. But it is compared with a bubble because this consciousness, what is its time period? It is beginningless, it is endless, it is eternal. That which is eternal compared to an eternal thing, what is some few millions or billions of years? It is like a bubble only. So this Parameshwari, which is the Akhiladhara, which is the Upadana Karana, this, now remember, who is this Parameshwara? Don't say some Parameshwara, me. This is the way you have to see. I, the pure consciousness in me, millions and billions of galaxies rise and they die down. I remain unaffected by them. This is the way you have to see. Just like the bubbles appear, insignificantly they appear and then they disappear. In the same way, all these stars and the galaxies, everything, they appear from me, they dissolve in me. Who am I? I am pure consciousness. Now see again how the vision changes with knowledge. Earlier in ignorance, what I used to think of myself? I am a bubble. I am a bubble in this world. For some time I roam around and then die. Isn't it? Forget about galaxy, etc. In this little earth itself, I am a bubble. I am a speck of a dust. In this infinite universe, there is something called Milky Way. In one galaxy, there are millions and billions of galaxies. In that one galaxy, in that one solar system, in that one earth, in that earth, what do you call it? One country. In that country, one state. In that state, one district. In that district also, one city or a town. And in that, one hall. And inside the hall, we are all sitting. This is our understanding now. So, we consider ourselves in our ignorance as a bubble in this vast universe, isn't it? But what happens with knowledge? You don't see yourself as a bubble. You see this entire cosmos as mere bubble existing in you. See the change of vision. This is what happens when you shift your attention from mere physical body to the consciousness in you. You expand infinitely. The same idea is again brought forth in the next verse. Verse number 9.
Sachidatmanyanusyute nitye vishnau prakalpitah vyaktayo vividha sarva hatake kataka divat.
Yes. Prakalpita, everything is projected. What are the things projected? Sarva vividha vyaktaya, all these varieties of manifestations like things and beings. All these manifestations that we see, they are all prakalpitaha, projected. Projected upon what? Sachit atmani anusyute nitye vishnau. They are projected upon sachit atmani, in the self, which is existence, consciousness. Everything is projected upon me, the existence consciousness principle, which is anusyute, which is all-pervading, which is nitye, which is eternal, Vishnu, that supreme Vishnu. So I, the existence consciousness bliss, I, the all-pervading self, upon me, everything is projected. Vishnu, the term Vishnu means Vyapakatvat Vishnu, the one who is all-pervading. Vishnu. Earlier the term used was Parameshwari. Verse number 8. Parameshwara is used. Parameshwara is Shiva. Now in this verse Vishnu is used. What does it mean? Vishnu or Parameshwara, both are one and the same. There is no difference. You call it Vishnu or Shiva or Ganesha, Rama, Krishna, whomever you call, ultimately they are none other than your own self, which is nothing but existence consciousness. So upon this existence consciousness, everything is projected. To make it clear, one example is given. What is the example? Hatake katakadivat. Just like all the ornaments are projected on the gold. What is the essential substance? Gold. But then we have so many names and forms on the gold. So something you call it necklace, something you call it bangle, nose ring, earring, this, that, etc. So many things are there. What are they? They are nothing but names of certain forms. But what is the essential content? Gold. When you weigh necklace, what are you weighing? Gold. Isn't it? When you are talking of the properties of necklace, what are you talking of? The properties of gold. Isn't it? The price for which you are paying, the price you are paying for gold. It may have so many different utilities. Ornaments, some are worn in the ear, different parts of the body, but essentially it is nothing but gold. Nama, rupa, name and form has no value at all. What is important is the content. In the same way, the whole world you see, you see so many things. Trees are there, plants are there, animals are there, insects are there, birds are there, sky is there, moon is there. But what is the essential content in them? The essential content is nothing but existence, consciousness, sat, chit, nothing else. This way we must see. The whole world is projected in me, the infinite consciousness. There is nothing which is existing other than me. I alone exist. My own mind, taking my existence, is projecting these things upon me, the substratum. If this vision you have, then your vision is the right vision. This is the perfect vision. This is a Vedantic vision. Just like the entire movie is projected on the white screen. So even when you are seeing the movie, what are you actually looking at? You are looking only on the white screen. That is the substratum. All shades and colors have no meaning at all. What really is only the screen. In the same way, in the screen of consciousness, the whole movie world is projected. Whatever you see, the mind is projecting the whole thing. You give existence to them. By itself, they don't have any existence. This way you have to meditate at the seat of meditation. Bhagwan, tell me one thing. Now you say everything is projected on this consciousness, but I feel the consciousness is there in each and every one of us. It appears to be different. When we see the world, just like I have consciousness, I find that others also have consciousness. So it appears as though this consciousness is divided. It doesn't appear to be one. Bhagwan, will you please explain? So the next verse is about that. Verse number 10.
Yathakasho Rishikeshah Nanopadhigato Vibhuh Tadbhedadbhinnavadbhati Tannashe Kevalo Bhavet.
Yes. So Bhagavan says, no, this consciousness, it appears to be different because of different conditionings. Because of different conditionings, this consciousness appears to be different in different people. Just like yatha akashah, like space. This is the example given. How many spaces are there in this world? There is only one space. But still, in our transaction, we use the term, isn't it? Kitchen space, bathroom space, dining hall space, this space, that space. We use so many different terminologies. But actually, how many spaces is there? Only one. Then how do we feel that these spaces are all different? It is all because of the conditionings. The walls as though divide the space, but actually the space is not divided. In fact, everything exists in space. Bhagwan says the same with consciousness also. Now it appears as though the consciousness in me is different from you, is different from her, him, etc. It appears different. It is not. All the beings are existing in consciousness. This is the truth. Just like all the little spaces are existing in one total space. Tad bhedat bhinnavad bhati. The conditionings are different, therefore it appears as though the space inside each and every conditioning is different. Tannashe kevalo bhavet. When you pull down all the walls, what happens? You don't have to pull down. You have to just imagine if those conditionings are removed, what remains is only one. The property of the conditioning as though affects the space. Suppose the car is moving. Inside the car there is space. So what do we say? It appears as though the space is also moving, isn't it? But actually, does the space move? No. But when the conditioning moves, it appears as though the space is also moving. In the same way, when the living being, say we walk around, it appears as though consciousness is moving here and there. But actually consciousness doesn't move. To give another example, the light is there. Now in that light you are seeing this hand. So when this hand is moving, what is moving? Is the light moving? But the light is appearing to move, isn't it? Everywhere I go, there is a light which is reflected on the hand. So it appears as though light is also moving. Actually, light is not moving. Light is everywhere. So wherever the hand goes, the light there gets reflected. In the same way, consciousness is everywhere. But in our ignorance, we think consciousness is limited to this body. More discussion about consciousness will come later. This consciousness is infinite. It can never be conditioned. It only appears to get limited through various conditioning, like space. More of it we will see tomorrow. Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pasyantu. Ma kaschit dukkha bhag bhavet asato ma sadgamaya tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrityorma amratam gamaya om shanti 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 hari om shri gurubhyo namaha. Hari Om.